Welcome to this episode of the Girardian Virtual Bible Study. My name is Adam Erickson, and I am here with my dear friend and colleague at the Raven Review, Lindsay Paris Lopez. Hi, Lindsay. How are you?
Hi, Adam. I'm okay.
Yeah, I am great because you and I, for people watching on YouTube and the Facebook page, I'm wearing a Resist shirt and you are wearing a Persist shirt.
Yes, with a cat. I have to stand up a little bit.
Yes, Persist.
Persist, yes.
Yes, and my shirt has this Lady Liberty on it, and it says Resist. And the reason that we are wearing these shirts is because in the New Testament passage today, Jesus gets a little political. He's resisting and he is persisting.
He is. He is. There's also a lot of animal imagery. So the cat fits in nicely with that.
Yes, the cat fits in perfectly with that. We've got foxes and we've got hens. And what do you do with all of those? It's going to be a lot of fun to talk about. But first, I want to include our Genesis reading for this Sunday because, you know me, I just love the Hebrew Bible and what it's getting at. And so we're going to be reading Genesis 15, verses 1 through 12, and then it skips some stuff and goes 17 to 18. And then where Jesus gets political is in Luke chapter 13, verses 1 through 13, I think. Anyway, we'll get to that soon. But should we just dive into Genesis? Let's do that.
Yeah, let's do that.
Okay, all right. Well, I will read the Genesis passage. This is a passage about Abram. And you may remember in Genesis 12, God comes to Abram before he is Abraham and says, I'm going to make of you a great nation so that you will be a blessing to all of the nations of the earth. And this is like the great, this is the great blessing that God gives Abraham. It's a blessing not just for Abraham and Abraham's descendants, but it's the blessing to be a blessing to all the nations of the earth. And what's so fantastic about this is that it starts this movement that God blesses you in order that you can, as Jesus says, love your neighbor as you love yourself, right? So that's where this radical transformation of the understanding of God comes from. It's not just for you, it's for all the families of the earth.
Right. So blessings were always meant to be shared. If they're not shared, they're not blessings.
Blessings should be multiplied, not divided. I love it. Mm-hmm. Yes. And that's like the whole mission that Abraham and Abraham's descendants are on. Now, there's a problem, right? Because Abraham and Sarah get older and they're barren. And so that's part of the drama in it, is that they don't have descendants and God has to do something about it. So this is part of that story, part of that narrative. So here is Genesis chapter 15, verses 1 through 12 and 17 to 18. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, you have given me no offspring, and so a slave born in my house is to be my heir. But the word of the Lord came to him, this man shall not be your heir. No one but your very own issue shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said, look towards heaven and count the stars. If you are able to count them, then he said to him, so shall your descendants be. And he believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. Then he said to him, I am the Lord who brought you from Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to possess. But he said, O Lord God, how am I to know that I shall possess it? He said to him, bring me a heifer 3 years old, a female goat 3 years old, a ram 3 years old, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. He brought him all of these and cut them in two, laying each half over against the other, but he did not cut the birds in two. And when the birds of prey came down on the carcasses, Abram drove them away. As the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and a deep and terrifying darkness descended upon him. When the sun had gone down and it was dark, a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch passed between these pieces. On the day that the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying, "To your descendants I give this land, and from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates." Here ends our lesson this morning. That's weird stuff, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Like, yeah. It's, yeah, right? Like, what the heck does this have to do with the modern world? This is God promising Abram that even in their barrenness, God is with them. God remains with them. And you can interpret this in a way where, like, sometimes you're just spiritually dry. I mean, we're in the middle of Lent, right? And we're in the desert, and we feel like in the desert, the spirituality of the desert, you can start to feel barren. And Jesus, I'm sure, felt some like he wasn't getting life out in the desert. And yet you have this sense that God is with you even in these very difficult times. But there's the thing that, from a Girardian perspective, that I want to get at in here is this whole sacrificial business. Okay, so yeah. Abram says, "How will I know?" And God says, "Okay, go get some animals and chop them up, and that will be enough for you to know that this is going to happen, that I'm with you." And here's the Girardian perspective for me. Is this is clearly a bloody sacrifice, and what do you do with that? Here's what the Hebrew Bible does, like right at the beginning with this sacrificial stuff. In the ancient world, when you had all of this anxiety, Abram has all of this anxiety because he's given these promises from God, and yet they don't seem to be coming true. And what do you do with this anxiety that's in your culture? You tend to need an outlet for that anxiety. And that outlet in the ancient world was to kill another person, to sacrifice someone else in order to appease the gods. Well, the Hebrew brilliance is that God doesn't want you to sacrifice people, right? And so the movement begins away from sacrificing people to sacrificing animals. Okay, so that's why there is all of this emphasis on in the Hebrew Bible about sacrificing animals, and you have to do it this way, and they need to be 3 years old, because you never know if you're doing it quite right, and you never know if it's going to be good enough for God, right?
Yeah.
So there is a sense in which you need to jump through some hoops in order to get rid of that anxiety, not because God is against you, because God's for Abram and Sarah and Sarah's descendants throughout this whole thing. So God is for them already, but Abram doesn't trust it. So God gives these hoops for Abram to jump through so that he can trust the promises of God. Now, the story continues, right? So that God doesn't, in Hosea, God doesn't want sacrifice. God wants mercy. And it continues to the Jewish Jesus, where Jesus says, "Hey, you know what? If you've got an issue with your brother or your sister, don't go to the temple to make a sacrifice. Go directly to your brother or your sister," right? So there's this God element of it, where God is on your side the whole time, Abram, but you don't trust it. And so that's the God element. There's the human element where, hey, don't worry about making a sacrifice to God, because you don't need to get God on your side. God's already on your side. But go to your fellow human beings and try to work it out there.
Yes. Yes. Go back to the origin of the conflict, because sacrifice is the end of first the conflict, then the violence, and the escalation of the violence, then the resolution where everyone comes together and does collective violence and all feel relieved together. So, Jesus saying, go and make peace with your brother before you come back, is really subverting all of that. But without a Girardian lens, it's so easy to miss. And it's easy to miss because it's all hidden. It's hidden, and we don't see it, which is the point of the whole scripture story showing it to us.
Yes.
And
Yeah, and it starts with the beginning of Abraham in Genesis 12, go be a blessing to all the nations of the earth, which means don't sacrifice other people. Be a blessing to other people. So it starts there. But here, like another element of this that I want to do very quickly is this is a covenant that God makes with Abram. And Abram is called to cut animals to make this sacrifice. The word for covenant and cut are related in Hebrew. Like they mean basically the same thing. So when you are when you're making a covenant with another person, in the ancient world, you would often sacrifice an animal. In the Hebrew tradition as well, when you made a covenant with someone, you would cut an animal, not another person, but an animal, and you would share that animal between you as food, mm-hmm. as a sign that you are in this mutually together. So that's what this sacrifice is about. God and Abram are in this relationship together, not over and against anyone else, but in a way that they are working together for the benefit of all the families of the earth.
Mm-hmm. So what we think about making a bargain now is I give this, I give up this, you give up that. I make this sacrifice in the sense of this is something I want to keep, but I will let go of this condition or give this up to you in order that you will let go of that condition and give it up to me. Mm-hmm. And it's still the way we consider making bargains today. But if we can shift from I give up this in order to gain this to this is what we can do together, and we will both be the better for it, and we will both be the happier for it. So that our bargains aren't zero-sum games, but, mutually beneficial. I think that human understanding of bargaining is continually evolving in our minds, and it's evolving through the scripture too.
Yep. And one of the great things about the story is that Abram doesn't trust it. Mm-hmm. Right? And how does God respond? God doesn't respond to Abram by saying, oh, you jerk, just have more faith. God comes to Abram and says, well, what can I do to help you trust this from me, right? God doesn't get angry. God doesn't get annoyed. God just comes to Abram as God is always for us. How can I help you do this? And that's where the sacrifice of the animals comes mm-hmm. in.
And it's really, as always, as we see ultimately in the gospel, it's God's sacrifice to us to give us a sign that we can understand from the one who has never desired sacrifice and has always desired mercy, including on those poor animals that I'm sure God is mending back together in heaven and saying, I'm so sorry.
Yes, yes. Those humans just didn't get it and they needed something. So thank you.
So thank you.
Yes. Okay, well, let's move to Luke chapter 13. Do you want to read that passage?
Sure. It's Luke chapter 13, I believe it's verses 31 through 35. So fairly short, but really packed with meaning. So at that very hour, some Pharisees came and said to him, get away from here, for Herod wants to kill you. He said to them, go and tell that fox for me. Listen, I am casting out demons and performing cures today and tomorrow, and on the third day I finish my work. Yet today, tomorrow, and the next day I must be on my way, because it is impossible for a prophet to be killed outside of Jerusalem. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often have I desired to gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you are not willing. See, your house is left to you, and I tell you, you will not see me until the time comes when you say, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Good stuff.
Good stuff.
Yeah.
Go tell that fox.
Well, okay. Okay. So when we hear the word fox, we're probably thinking some sly animal, some animal that's what would you say? It's sly? What?
Yeah, sly, cunning, crafty. The yes. fox is the one that eats the gingerbread man because he outsmarts him.
Right. Yeah.
So yeah.
But that's not what Jesus means here when he calls Herod a fox. And this is part of where Jesus is resisting the political authorities of his day. And he has to persist all the way to the cross, right?
Yes.
Yes, so that's what is meant by when Jesus says, I have to go to Jerusalem. It means mm-hmm. he's going to the cross. He knows by this mm-hmm. moment, he knows what resisting and persisting is going to lead him to do. But what is meant by fox for Jesus?
So according to Shane Claiborne and Chris Hall, who did their research too, didn't just make this up, I read this in a book called Jesus for President. So you don't get much more political than that. They said that Jesus is calling Herod a coward, an imposter, a thief. He has come about his rule dishonestly. Actually, he inherited his rule, so there's a whole system behind him. This mm-hmm. is Herod Antipas, and he's the son of Herod the Great, who killed everyone he thought was a threat to him, but failed to actually kill Jesus. So this is Herod Antipas, his son, and so he has inherited a system of power that has come through cheating, oppression, and cozying up to the bigwigs who in this case are Rome. In modern day, it would be the American Empire, among other things. I mean, we are not exempt from any of this critique. This is Herod is ruling over the weak, and he himself is weak. He's ruling at the behest of even stronger powers, but those stronger powers aren't just either. They are powers of conquest, oppression. So Jesus is saying, this is not legitimate.
Right.
And he's saying, I'm not going to stop my legitimate work because of that fox. So I'm going to keep doing what I'm doing. And you know, it's just a really badass attitude that Jesus is giving here. It really is.
Yeah. I think one way that a sermon could deal with this is to point out the names. So Jesus comes from the Hebrew word for Yeshua, which means savior, mm-hmm. refers to savior. Antipas, Herod Antipas, anti means against in Greek, and Pas means everything, right? So Herod Antipas is the fox who is, like, names matter, especially in the Hebrew tradition. Antipas is like, he's against everything that Jesus stands for, right? So Jesus is the one who is going to save the world through what? Through, he says, go tell that fox, listen, I am casting out demons and performing cures today and tomorrow, and on the third day, I finish my work. Jesus is the savior of the world, not through power and violence over and against everything. Mm-hmm. The one who is the savior of the world, who is the power to heal, the power to bring life to the world.
Right.
So that could be something fun to play with as well. And it's also fulfilling the Abrahamic promise of being a blessing to all the nations of the earth. But at the same time, Jesus, as you say, has this badass move where he's not afraid to name the powers and principalities that are in the world.
Mm-hmm.
What they they are.
Right.
Or the foxes that they are. So that's how Jesus isn't killed, because he tells us to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. Nobody would kill somebody for that. Jesus is killed because he names the powers for what they are.
Right. And so it's so important to point out that naming violence is not the same as committing violence, but it is a threat to violence. Naming violence means violence cannot continue, so insidiously. It can't, you know, it's violence is very brazen, out in the open stuff, but it's been so whitewashed and justified and just so built into our culture that we don't name it as such. And to name violence means that it is unraveling, and violence, you know, whether it's a system of racism or homophobia or bigotry, violence tends to escalate when it's called out, when it feels threatened. It tends to fight back. There tends to be pushback. But naming the violence itself is not violent. And so Jesus calls out the violence, and then we see the violence essentially in its death throes, giving all it has to resist. And the more violence does that, the more it's exposed for what it really is.
Yes. And I think it's important. There are some dangers in this. And one of those dangers is thinking that the fox is only in other people. And throughout the New Testament, we see how the disciples end up acting very foxy, yeah. Right? They abandon Jesus. They're the cowards. Like, if a fox is a coward, the disciples are the ones who are the cowards, who run away in the end. And so there's a sense in which, yeah, Herod's a fox, but so am I. So are the disciples. Yeah. And there are countless times when I see injustice in our world. And as a white heterosexual male, I cower in fear because I have some privileges in this world. And one of the things that I have to resist and persist in is continuing to see that within myself, the fox within myself, and naming it for what it is, so that I can go out into the world and do this very hard work.
Mm-hmm. And it is very hard work, and it's and it can be painful work. So Jesus goes around and he points out where the foxes lie in each of us and heals us from them. Mm-hmm. So Jesus is going around casting out demons. I think the demons are both our sense of complicity in the world and our sense of shame about that complicity. Everything that prevents us from participating in the transformation of those powers so that they can be restored to goodness instead of used against us and against humanity. I think those are the demons that are just so permeate the air we breathe that we can't help but take them into ourselves, and Jesus comes and casts them out. So Jesus's work is both to call out the evil and then to tenderly summon it out of us and heal us as he goes along. I mean, he talks about casting out demons and healing. Mm-hmm. And that goes for everyone. I mean, Herod included, you know, and Pilate included, and Rome included, everyone. He's
yes.
trying to cast out all of our demons and heal all of us.
Yes, yes. And you say Jesus does this tenderly. And I think the image that is great to end on here is the mother hen image. Mm-hmm. Because if it's me, if this is me, and I'm a disciple in the first century, I want Jesus to use a different animal imagery. If Herod is the fox, I want Jesus to be the lion of Judah. I don't want Jesus to be a mother hen. That's weak. I want Jesus to be the lion. And this is the imagery that we see frequently throughout the Bible, that the imagery of the lion, the Messiah, to be the lion, the powerful one. But Jesus uses the hen.
Right, right.
Which on one level is so disappointing, but on another level, as you point to, is very tender. And it is the, when you are the lion, when you are like the fox or something more predatory like the lion, you're just, as you were saying earlier, you're just increasing the violence in the world. Mm-hmm. That's what that imagery does. So Jesus takes it to a whole different plane.
Right.
The model is a mother hen.
Right, yes. And that's beautiful. And I think in Revelation, where they have the image of the Lion of Judah, you immediately see Jesus not as a lion, but as the slain lamb.
Yes.
Slain lamb. And the hen, of course, is the fox's prey. So the hen may protect all of her baby chicks in the face of the fox, but the fox is going to get that hen. And maybe stuff himself so much that he won't want the chicks. I don't, honestly, to really try to think about how this is protection gets problematic because violence still exists. Mm-hmm. And nonviolence in the face of violence, the only way it works, and it doesn't work without bloodshed, it doesn't work without people dying. It doesn't work without, you know, violence. Violence is ultimately stopped by nonviolence, but not before people are killed. And I mean, we just have to be honest about that and about how scary that is. I think the reason it works is because these are just metaphors and we are human, and built into our humanity is a conscience, is, you know, that we are created in the image of love. And I think that does click. I think it does sink in after a while. But I think not before violence has had its way. But violence has had its way all through the beginning. I mean, the nonviolent path is hard and it's long, but the violent path hasn't gotten us anything except more violence.
Well, yeah, violence is risky and nonviolence is risky. They're both risky. But there have been so many nonviolent movements that are peaceful, that haven't
ended. I know. And I'm not discounting that. I'm not discounting them. I'm just saying that people died in those movements.
Yes.
I mean, we have to acknowledge the cost. And they have, nonviolent movements, I mean, have brought us more peace. And that's wonderful, but people have died and been imprisoned and lost a lot. So Jesus's followers lose a lot. So we have to be honest about the cost, and Lent really keeps those costs ahead of us. And because we are so afraid of the costs, we, you know, that's kind of what keeps us in the sacrificial mindset to begin with. Mm-hmm. We're afraid of the costs to ourselves, and we want to pass them on to someone else. So we don't want to be killed, and so we become killers. And I think that's how the whole notion of sacrifice began, and working through it to peace is a difficult process. But I mean, it's the end of it is I can't even imagine when we're all actually living in peace together, how much better than my imagination it will be.
Absolutely. And just a reminder that our reading from Genesis today brings us back to your point. God comes to Abram and says, "Do not be afraid."
Right.
Do not be afraid. That's like constantly throughout the Bible. It tells us, don't be afraid. It's going to be okay. God is with us. So in death and Lent brings us into Good Friday, where Jesus dies. But Good Friday doesn't have the last word. Easter and resurrection have the last word. So don't be afraid, the Bible tells us. So Lindsay, thank you for this conversation on the second Sunday of Lent. And everybody, I hope you can join us next Wednesday at 10 o'clock Central, 8 o'clock Pacific, as we discuss the third Sunday of Lent, as we continue our Lenten journey to the cross and through the cross and into the resurrection. Until then, grace and peace be with you. Bye-bye.